astrology began thousands of years ago, and it dates back to the Chaldeans and the Babylonian times. And the astrological signs are closely related to, but not in connection with anymore, due to the precession of the equinoxes, closely related to the various constellations that appear in the night sky. These constellations were noted by astronomers and astrologers. In fact, in those days, astrologers, astronomers, physicians, all fell under the same category. Shaman and healers is what they were called, knowledge persons, mystics, people who had practical associations with the stars and with the planets. Now, the signs of the zodiac, means animals, and a lot of the signs are animal types, and there are a few non-organic and non-human types of signs, and as we go through each astrological sign, we'll discover some of the myths that go behind the astrological signs, talk a little bit about the planets that rule them, the qualities, and also the elements that the different signs are associated with. And the elemental factor in signs, for instance, the first element is fire, has a lot to do with exuberance, has a lot to do with dynamism, excitement, projection, intuition. In fact, intuition is largely determined by the amount of listening that one can do to their inner self. The word intuition derives from the root to be taught from within. So the fire signs are, in fact, the intuitive signs. This doesn't mean psychic, and it doesn't mean that they're clairvoyant, but it means that a lot of their stimulus, a lot of their energy, and a lot of their thrust into the world is largely determined by the level of inspiration that they have in their lives. The next element that we deal with is the earth element, the element of earth. And it's just as it sounds. It's grounded. It has to do with the realm of the practical world. It has to do with the tangible form, the world of form. The world of form is not something to be scorned, but something to be used. And it's another key word for an earth sign. And the earth signs are associated always with the utilization of the world of form, with the practical aspects of life, with the real sensual part of life, the part that feels, the part that actually does, that acts. It's not an esoteric concept. The next element that is frequently associated with the feeling part of our natures that we all share is the water element. And the element water is really one of the more powerful elements. It can be the most destructive, and it also can be the most creative. Water comes in many forms. Water on planet Earth can take the form of a fast rushing river, can take the form of an ocean, a vast oceanic space. It can also take the form of a stagnant pond. Water has many forms. It always sinks to the lowest level, in which case it does seem to have that all-permeating sense of belonging to the earth. It is contained by the earth. It quenches fire. Fire makes water boil. Fire dries out earth, and earth can smother fire. There are four elements in the tangible world. The other one, the last, is air. And the air element is associated with the thinking factors, the objective and associative factors that we share with each other when we are in a communication state. So the function of air is really all-permeating, isn't it? It has to do with the invisible alembic that communication waves, transference takes place in this area, in the air area. Air can take the form of turbulence in the sense of a wind or a tornado. So air is not necessarily a peaceful element either, because if we had peace constantly in our natures, we would then lack a certain amount of developmental tension or stress that allows us to create different forms within existent situations. Each of the signs in the zodiac is associated with one of these elements. They're also associated with properties of activity, modes of expression. Modes of expression are often described as being, say, a go-getter or laid back or highly excitable. in astrology, we categorize naturally the signs with various types of modes of expression. The first mode of expression is cardinal, which is initiatory, gets things going, starts things off, loves the challenge of life, loves to get going and moving in new directions, very anxious to achieve. And the next thing that follows, which would be a natural, really a natural evolution of experience, would be once something has been created, once something has been founded and has been established in an ongoing sense, we need maintenance for these existent forms. So the signs that are the fixed signs, which is another form of quality, we had cardinal. The fixed signs have more to do with stability, maintenance, actualizing things, creating a reality out of the possible realms of experience that we have, which automatically leads into a third and extremely important, just as important, equally. In fact, as we go through the astrological signs, you'll see that there's no one sign more important or more necessary than the other. So the third quality of astrological sign symbolism is mutable. Mutable is the concept of falling away, of adapting, of changing, and becoming more in tune with the existing circumstances. So the mutable signs have more to do with adapting to existing situations and being as spontaneously creative as possible. Obviously, with each of these characteristics, depending on certain times, certain places, different situations, they can be either positive or negative. Everything has a shadow. Nothing is perfect. Life is a series of, you know, actions and reactions, and it can be quite a bit of fun. It can also be quite stressful. And today, we look at astrology as a tool for maximizing potential, rather than the fateful, event-oriented type of astrology, which I certainly find no fault with, because that is where we come from. We come from the old masters of fateful astrology. In fact, astrology has evolved over the last couple of hundred years to achieve a fairly credible association in personality. And when I talk about the signs, when I describe astrological signs, I'm not talking about personalities. I'm talking about processes of development. I'm talking about part of us that we all carry around. There are 12 astrological signs. At some point, we will at any given time be asked to divulge our astrological sign, which is fun. It's not necessarily going to be terribly accurate if we discuss our natures according to the sign that the sun was transiting at the time of our birth. However, it's very relevant when we get a global picture of the celestial sphere and the planets that are seen against the backdrop of the zodiacal signs. We then get what is called a horoscope. The basis of the horoscope are the astrological signs, the planets as seen against the backdrop of these signs, and the sector of the sky in which they appear at various times on a very regular basis in the course of a 24-hour period. In a 24-hour period, even to the layman eye, it is clear that the sun is going to rise, culminate, and set. And it seems to disappear for half of a day, half of a 24-hour period approximately, and rise again. There's a very regular rhythm. Every 4 minutes, the sun will travel across 1 degree across the sky and bring with it a new rising sign or a new ascendant area, and that will define for you as an individual the makeup of your astrological horoscope. Horoscope means map, our map. In other words, the time of day will present a unique and very personal map. Within everyone's horoscope are 12 signs. Those 12 signs are not necessarily going to be inhabited or utilized, if I put it that way, by planets. However, a number of them will be. Each of us has within us one each of the 12 processes of development, Aries through Pisces. Now, as I mentioned earlier, there are qualities and elements that are associated with the signs. And the first sign of the zodiac is Aries. The sign of Aries implies spring. Though our focus, our viewpoint, our vantage point here on Earth has altered in the course of the last couple of thousand years, and we don't really see zero Aries rising on March the 21st, what we really have is a symbolic and very workable zodiac system. The first sign is Aries, as I mentioned. Aries rules the first part of the sector of the chart. It has very much to do with the whole concept of birth, of spring, of coming alive, the part of us that experiences the desire for a new beginning, the desire for challenge, for externalization of goals, for aggressiveness, assertiveness. Also, hostility and anger can be expressed through the sign of Aries. The god that was associated with the sign of Aries is Mars. Mars was the old god of war. Now, we have to declare war sometime, and we understand that the declaration of war is relative only if it's necessary. So what we look at Mars, Aries, as is the capacity to express excitement through heat and through energy. In fact, Mars is called Eris in many of the mythological tales. Oddly enough, Mars is not one of the gods that is mentioned greatly. He definitely has a bad reputation. This does not mean that all Aries are violent and warmongers, not at all. In fact, Aries are very sensitive people, extremely sensitive. Sensitive in a sense that if you consider that the Aries symbolism embodies spring, what we have there is a certain tenderness, a certain vulnerability as the new shoot comes from under the earth after having been kept, let's say, in incubation or in gestation through the latter months of the year, and provides for us on planet Earth a beautiful new beginning. But you have to realize that new beginnings are always a little shaky, always a little nervous, somewhat insecure. Part of us is dying to get out there and do something entirely different and do something very, you know, strong, powerful, exciting, challenging, new. Aries is a cardinal sign. It's also a fire sign. So what we're combining with these two particular elements and qualities is we're combining the excitement and the intensity and the intuitiveness of fire, as well as we are experiencing the new beginnings with cardinal. So we have a cardinal fire sign, Aries, ruled by the planet Mars, very much involved in just being born. So wherever you have Aries in your horoscope, or if you are an Aries, in other words, if when you were born, the sun was seen against the backdrop of the sign Aries, this would include you as a person who needs to have new beginnings, exciting things, something entirely different. And if Mars is the old god of war, he actually was an offspring of Zeus and Hera. Now, Zeus was, when we get to our Sagittarius sign, really the ruler of the old Greek gods after a bit of a war. Aries, as I said, is ruled by Mars. Mars has two moons, Deimos and Phobos, panic and fear. Now, this really begins to sound like an extremely intense situation, and yet what we're really looking at is that essential thrust into life that is so important in order to be born. Aries is like birth. The psychology of Aries, I've mentioned, really, it's excitable, it's intuitive, operating on impulse, very exciting sign, is associated with the color red. It also is followed by the sign of Taurus, and it's preceded by the sign of Pisces. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the signs themselves are really processes of development. They're not isolated individual states of mind. They are an evolutionary development. Aries is preceded by Pisces, which is the sign that is associated with sort of the decay and the gestation period prior to a birth or an experience. And it leads into the sign of Taurus, which is a sign that if we think of each sign as a process of development, and integrally involved with each and every other sign, we have to recognize that Aries is exhausting and one must take some time and become a little more placid, little more relaxed, and a lot more easygoing. Also, it takes a certain quality of stubbornness. So, you know, the sign of Taurus has actually got kind of a bad reputation. In fact, every sign has a bad reputation. Taurus has a bad reputation because it's so incredibly easygoing. Aries is saying, come on, let's go. Taurus is saying, no, I think I'm just going to sit back here and feel a little more comfort and not get quite so excited about life. I'm going to get some quality out of life. I'm going to get something that's a little more stable, a little more permanent. And so as a quality of our identity and as a process of development within us, Taurus represents the capacity to become, let's say, firm. It's an earth sign. Taurus is also a fixed sign. Fixed earth is probably, just if you become more involved with the moods of elements and processes of development, a fixed sign that is also of an earth quality, and of course it's the only one because there's only one of each representation, is one of stability, of sensuality, of feeling the earth, of feeling involved, of really enjoying the comforts of life. So there's a lot of that kind of sensuality that goes along with the Taurus sign that within us is the one that loves gourmet food and expensive wines and fur seats in the car. I mean, this type of thing. I'm not saying indeed that Taurus is materialistic in a negative sense, but certainly it needs to learn how to cope, how to deal with, and how to maximize the world of form in order to experience comfort. Rejection of these values can result in the opposite, the polar opposite experience within Taurus. Each sign has within it two ways of coping. The extreme other aspect of Taurus is one of self-denial, the ascetic. There are as many ascetic Tauruses as there are corpulent wine tasters in that sign. In fact, the ruler of Taurus is Venus. Venus shares a rulership with another sign, as we'll soon discover. In fact, Venus has two sides to her. There's Venus, the beautiful, wonderful, lovely, gorgeous, beautiful goddess, and then there's Aphrodite, that unconscious, oceanic, consuming aspect of femininity, which we all dread because it is so incredibly inclusive of everything. Venus as a goddess, as a ruler of Taurus, really activates the whole beauty and the beast syndrome. In other words, we have the concept of loveliness, of balance and harmony, but we have to understand our value system before we can really experience the sign of Taurus to its fullest. Taurus allows you to experience yourself as an individual, as a person of worth, a person of value, a person who is allowed to state their case and let it rest. The fixity of Taurus definitely has something to do with our ability to stand firm and say no, and to maintain a position. Also, the quality of Earth allows it to become stable and allows that quality of Taurus, which we all love, is you can always count on this sign to basically be who it's going to be. However, when we begin to move again into yet another process, we are going to find that the next sign has a certain restlessness to it that denies the Taurian stability, that says, I am so tired of sitting here on the farm feeling good and growing things and buying wonderful expensive objects. I want to see more. I want to be more mobile. So the next quality that evolves from fixed is mutable. The mutable sign of Gemini, which is the third sign of the zodiac, has more to do with adapting to existing situations, changing reality, moving around as much as possible, gathering data indiscriminately. So Gemini is ruled by the old god Mercury, who was Hermes, another prodigy, offspring of Zeus, very virulent fellow. In fact, Hermes and Mercury, being one and the same, Contrary to Mars, Hermes spends more time involving himself in the affairs of everyone else that sometimes his own affairs were unattended. The sign of Gemini has this dual side to it. It has the positive and negative polarities. It has the capacity to see all sides. It is there whenever anything is going on. It certainly is one of the most excitable and one of the most intellectually active signs. All Geminis are not geniuses, and they are not all scattered. But we all have within us, as a process of development, the capacity to draw in indiscriminately data of various types. So the process of Gemini and the capacity to relate everything to everything else is very much a Gemini function. Its mutability allows it to fly from thing to thing. I mean, the god Mercury is depicted beautifully with a winged feet, winged hat, and a caduceus, which is like a magic wand. It's also the medical symbol. So Mercury's image is really one of the most beautifully depicted, and also one of the most frequently mentioned and frequently active members of the Olympian gods. Hermes Mercury is the ruler of the sign of Gemini, also is a dual ruler with the sign of Virgo to date. As we have 10 planets, we have 12 signs. As a result, two signs share rulerships of two planets. Now, what we're going to be trying to portray with the sign of Gemini is often a mixed message. The function of Gemini is to be able to observe, perceive, see, think, organize, sort, file. I mean, anything to do with the complexities of the mind is a Gemini function. Due to its mutability, there's the adaptable quality. This can be sometimes quite frustrating to us if we find that we're incapable, for example, of making a decision. We have a part of us that really does see both sides, that really is involved in a mental gymnastic kind of experience. Also, along with this whole experience of Mercury is that it is an air sign. And as I mentioned, the air sign is all permeating. Air has the potential to transfer, has the potential to become very hostile as well. But it's an interesting kind of hostility. The Gemini hostility is more of the academic variety. It's more of the planning type. In fact, the Gemini revenge would be one of the mind rather than one of the physical variety. And we see Gemini as processing part of our mind so that we have almost, say, two different kind of recording instruments going at the same time. So that we often find that the Gemini experience has more to do with being in as many places as possible at the same time. In fact, it's not uncommon for that sign to be involved in four or five things simultaneously. Not all of them obvious, of course. But you see, the first three signs, Aries, Taurus, and Gemini, have described the qualities of cardinal, initiatory, fixed, establishment, and mutable, adaption, very, very well. We've also experienced fire, intuitive, Aries. We've also experienced earth, very practical, Taurus. We've experienced air, very mental, very intellectual, as Gemini. We now begin on the next phase of signs, astrological signs, beginning with another cardinal sign. Only this time, it is a cardinal sign that is associated with water. The sign of Cancer is the next sign. Cancer is as tired of Gemini function as Taurus was holding off against its arrival. Now, the sign of Cancer is a very nurturing sign. Due to its cardinal nature, it certainly isn't weak. It is not to be associated with washing the dishes and cleaning the floors and staying at home all the time. In fact, this is a very, I would have to call this a modern myth in a sense, because poor Cancer, you know, they have a tendency to take this on personally. It also is totally unrelated to the disease. Cancer is a moon-ruled sign, the goddess of the moon, Diana. Interestingly enough, Diana and the goddess of the moon was the huntsman in chief, which is interesting because it does give the symbolism of the home and the hearth in a much more realistic sense. For example, when the signs began to evolve as processes of identity, the sign of Cancer, or the guardian of the hearth, the woman, in fact, because it's a moon-ruled sign. The woman was the protector of the hearth and also was the one who charged the hunters to go out. She guarded the home front, Diana, in order to protect her offspring and her home life. So that the goddess Diana is no weakling. This is a very powerful woman, a very powerful force that females will embody in a very conscious sense, and within every man is Cancer as well. The protector, the feminine, the anima. The moon, as ruler of Cancer, gives us an idea of the moodiness that can go along with this sign. The phases of the moon are the most obvious celestial phenomenon, very closely related to the changes of mood, changes of mind, different visions that the sign Cancer will have. The key to its power lies in the knowledge that Cancer is a cardinal sign. Therefore, Cancer likes to begin things, it likes to start things, but it's water, so it's everywhere. Very powerful, very emotionally oriented. In fact, the water signs, as I had mentioned earlier, have much to do with our emotional basis in life. Cancer represents the northern part of the horoscope, in other words, the lower part, the nadir, in the natural wheel, and therefore is a protector of the security factors in life. Security is important. You wouldn't be able to create anything. You would have no basis in reality if you didn't have a sense of security. So wherever you see Cancer in your chart, or wherever you see the moon in its relationship with the sign Cancer that it rules, you see there your emotional basis in life. You then can relate to that as where you protect your fire, your hearth. Another aspect of the Cancer is that it has a lot to do with the whole psychological protectiveness that we all have to prevent invasion and intrusion. It's warm, loving. The, I think, awkward or negative aspect would have to be smothering, because this protectiveness, of course, can be too much. So that the Cancerian in nature, or the process within us that becomes overprotective, over-nurturing, is related very much to a misplaced sense of values that are more to do with the lunar qualities or the Cancerian qualities of our nature. Also, we see that Cancer was weary of the flitting about that Gemini produces, but Cancer also is the backdrop to the next sign, Leo. Leo is a fixed sign, in case nobody's noticed, if they have any Leo friends or anything in Leo. It has the qualities of fire, it's a fire sign. A lot of inspiration, a lot of flash, a lot of drama. If life isn't exciting, it isn't worth living. If there's no inspiration, they want to quit. They need stimulation, heat, warmth, and its ruling planet is the sun, which is a favorite image for me to relate the sign of Leo to the sun. The sun is the center of our solar system. Every other planet revolves around the sun. No wonder Leo thinks it's the center of the universe. It's perfectly normal. We all inhabit the world. We all carry with us archetypes of experience and archetypes of feeling. The Leo 9 feeling is one of warmth, one of luxury. It certainly is supported by Cancer. In fact, I call Cancer the power behind the throne, which is Leo. So we have our Leo with the sun-centered concept. We have it a fire sign, exciting, exuberant, externalizing, loving, fun, enjoyable, dramatic, challenging. All of the types of adjectives that could be applied to Leo all seem to suggest to us a very fun-loving and possibly even childlike nature that the Leo never really gets over. In fact, you can safely say that a Leo is a childlike individual. Not childish, but childlike. There's a youthful quality to that sign. If you take it, for instance, the Leo is the lion, as far as the astrological animal or symbol. Lions are notoriously lazy creatures. They would prefer it, if they could, to lay in a nice sunny glade, cleaning itself and playing with its offspring, going hunting once every 6 months and storing its food. Generally speaking, it's a fairly fun-loving sign, but it's also willful as all get out. Leo, I think, does need to experience itself as a focal point. Needing to experience ourselves as a focal point. Where do we find Leo in our own natal charts? Wherever it is, and wherever the sun is a really good way of discovering what is your purpose in life. Although we've always associated the sun with Apollo, we really see that the sun is fathered by Hyperion and is Helios. So we talk about a heliocentric solar system. Now really, if your ruling planet was the sun and all the planets revolved around it, wouldn't you feel like you were the center of the solar system too? Well, you are. We all are. We all have a place where we can shine, where our light can come out. In fact, a sunny personality is known to be a Leonine expression of self. Now, Leo, of course, has all the fun, everybody says. Well, not true. Not unless you spend only your time in the Leo part of your life. We also have another extremely important sign that follows Leo, that out of sheer necessity is there. It's the sign of Virgo. Another sign that has been poorly represented in the zodiac, much to the dismay of the Virgos in our lives. Sometimes we hear them saying, oh gee, I was born in September, or I'm sorry, I'm a Virgo. This is really unfortunate because the Virgo process, should we eliminate, let's say we eliminate Virgo out of our lives, what happens? We are incapable of reaching a rational conclusion. You don't want to think properly, you don't want to organize your mind and get everything in order and clean stuff up, make yourself useful. You see, Virgo has the quality of mutability, as did Gemini, but it also has the quality of Earth. And there's really nothing more reliable than Earth itself. The sun rising is pretty reliable, and the planet Earth is very reliable. It is through the process of learning to understand the factors of real life is where Virgo really shines. The practical parameters of life are a source of inspiration. Virgo is adaptable. It's a sign that is able to focus on a number of things at the same time, classifying, slotting, categorizing, taking care of business. Virgo is ruled by the planet Mercury, Hermes. And we talked about Mercury being one of the most visible gods in the pantheon. In fact, the wingedness of Mercury allows him to travel from place to place, delivering messages, picking up information, noticing things, never missing a thing, observing, classifying, and analyzing. You see, so the function of Virgo is not to be everybody's slave. However, I think that it would be safe to say that a Virgo who is not being used properly is not a happy Virgo. So the part of you that needs to feel useful, functional, that really thrives on being of service, of use to people, of being, if anything, very creative in that sense of service, is the Virgo function in its higher form. Of course, there's the shadow aspect. There is with every sign. As I mentioned, Leos can be very lazy. They're also a lot of fun. Virgos can also be a little over critical, a little over observant, in which case no one knows it better than themselves. No one knows your faults better than you, and that's basically what we're looking at when we talk about the polarities of the signs. What we've done to date, in other words, right up to this point, is we've discussed the first six zodiacal signs: Aries, Taurus, Gemini, Cancer, Leo, and Virgo. These are the first six signs. They are considered to be the very personal signs because this is the inner value system that we have set up. The sign of Aries has a lesson to learn, and it's how to be assertive without being bombastic. The lesson for Taurus is how to be firm without being stubborn, how to be sensual without being overindulgent. The lesson for the sign of Gemini is how to be quick and fleet of foot and mind without being scattered. How to be versatile without being in too many places at once. The sign Cancer has its admonitions as well. The sign Cancer is urged to be maternal, nurturing, without being smothering and manipulative. And Leo is encouraged to be intuitive, experiential, extroverted, without being overriding or, again, over-assertive, without being the center of the solar system all the time. The sign Virgo is meant to indicate to us that we need to analyze without being nitpicking. We need to be observant without being watchful. So you see, each sign has, as an archetypal experience, a lesson with each one. And we can then further ourselves by this brief philosophy. When we begin to move into the next signs, Libra on through Pisces, we're doing another thing. We're starting to look at each sign and its counterpart. Libra is the polarity of Aries. Libra is ruled by the planet Venus, whereas Mars was the ruler of Aries. So what we're really seeing is, we're seeing a polarity. If Mars is I am and I project myself into the world, Libra is I relate and I share and I learn how to live with other people. Venus, goddess of love, Aphrodite, goddess of oceanic, holocaustic type of feminine love, is the ruler of Libra. Now, Libra is associated not only with love and relationships, but also with the balances of justice, the balancing act of weighing and finding somewhere that we can relate on a much more balanced level with ourselves and with each other. It has much to do with inner harmony and refinement of value systems. Being ruler of Libra, Venus is a much more refined signature in Libra than it was in the sign of Taurus. So we have two functions of Venus, the sensual and the refined, artistic, more creative aspect of Venus. Venus, as ruler of Libra, gives Libra the actual feeling of this need for harmoniousness, this need of reflectiveness. Very often the sign of Libra, wherever it is found in your horoscope, or if you have Libra prominent, can indicate that also, as well as the other air sign, Gemini, you can see both sides, weighing and balancing. The lesson that Libra has to learn is that it's a cardinal sign, therefore it is of the initiatory variety, like Aries, like Cancer. It likes to get things going, doesn't like to be second. Cardinal signs like to be number one, and there's no way that they will not work toward being number one. In fact, Libra is a reaction from Virgo leading into Scorpio. So Libra is saying, oh, we must refine our knowledge. We must become more at peace with the world. In fact, Libra really has the concept within us of peace at any price. So we can see that the quality of cardinal represented in Libra means let's try something new in relationships. Sometimes Libra has too many relationships going on and has to really find some inner balance, because you're sure not going to find it if you're running around in the world trying to have 12 or 15 relationships. So most of us have a cutoff point when we realize we're oversaturated. I think that has to do with the cardinality, in other words, the need to get out there and experiment. But the air quality of Libra is neat. It's really objective. There's a quality to Libra that really can see the potential in everyone, that really does see that there is a way of communicating. Remember, the air signs were always associated with communication. So relating through communication is one of the keynotes for the sign Libra. Of course, it polarizes. Aries, it is others. Others. Aries is self. So there we have the mirror of ourselves in the sign of Libra. So the sign of Libra represents within us all the capacity to relate and to love and to share, and to share on an objective level. It's the justice. In fact, it is often related to law. The planet Saturn, though it's not the ruler, is exalted in Libra, giving us a sense of justice. Now, Libra is the sign that follows Virgo, as I mentioned. In other words, it is saying, hey, enough analysis, let's experiment with relationships. Libra wants breadth of experience, abhors breadth of experience, loves depth of experience. In fact, that could be taken to the extreme and to the fault of part of us. Part of our nature demands so much attention and so much intensity that at times we feel that we may be consumed by our own needs. So being consumed by our own needs is very frequently associated with the sign of Scorpio. Now, Pluto is the ruler of Scorpio. Pluto, in fact, only took over the rulership of Scorpio officially in February of 1930, which was the time at which it was sighted. Pluto is the most distant planet from the solar system center, the sun. Pluto at this time, 1985, 1986, 87, right into the middle of the, toward the end of the 80s, will remain within the orbit of Neptune. So for a while, Pluto is not the outermost planet. But Pluto has a lot of eccentricities to it that often, as most ruling planets with signs do, lend us an image of what is really going on. Now, if Scorpio demands depth, where experience and breadth of experience was occurring in Libra, then we're obviously going to be getting into some things that may be fairly unpleasant about ourselves and also fairly beautiful. See, the Pluto, as ruler of Scorpio, has noted for a couple of things. One of them is being the ruler of Hades, in other words, the underworld. But he also rules mines. In other words, that gem locked in raw material that has to be mined and brought out and polished and made into something of value. So Pluto is there for our pruning, really. So the sign of Scorpio rules the whole death-rebirth concept. The destructiveness of Pluto and the myth of Pluto taking Persephone and abducting her beneath the surface of the earth into the bowels of the earth has more to do with the whole concept of the unconscious mind. So there's many layers to the unconscious mind. And the sign of Scorpio has to do with the subterranean levels of our mind that allow us to process unconsciously a lot of garbage. In other words, holding in waste, holding in anger, holding in any type of negative feeling will result in an elimination problem. The whole function of Scorpio is to be able to eliminate negativity and to bring out from the bowels of the earth or the bowels of your unconscious mind some kind of gem that has to be mined. It's one of the most significant aspects to Scorpio and to Pluto, is that this is all done with a purpose. It is not done for meanness or out of thoughtlessness. In fact, Pluto is a very premeditated god, very, very much of the just god, ruthless, mind you, but just, the part of us that administers control over our nature and tries to get to the depths and tries to understand the layers of the unconscious mind is definitely the Scorpionic, Plutonic experience. So Pluto abducting Persephone and taking her beneath the surface of the earth allowed for the whole earth to be blanketed in winter until the bargain between Demeter and in the hands of Zeus allowed the reemergence of Persephone to the surface, thereby creating what we have now, our two main seasons, the summer, spring, winter, fall. Scorpio, therefore, does have something to do with the deeper regions of the unconscious mind. Has a lot to do with the resonance of emotiveness. It's a water sign. It's deep, it's fast running. It has to do with the layers of the psyche as you plow deeper and deeper into your unconsciousness. And it's also a fixed sign, stubborn, relentless, working all the time. We have water, all permeating, fixed, ever present. Scorpio, in fact, is so intense that the sign Sagittarius that follows it is like a breath of fresh air, literally. In fact, Sagittarius is a mutable sign. Again, another sign that is mutable. In other words, it is adaptable. It can change its ideas, its mind. Sagittarius has evolved out of the depths and the mysterious realms of Scorpio to bring to light some kind of belief system. Sagittarius is noted for its free thinking, its expansive philosophy, its capacity to reach into any area of life and understand it to some degree. We all have locked within us the desire for a belief system, a philosophy. We can't really exist here on planet Earth without something that gives us a feeling of reality, of something that gives us a feeling of belonging, of networking with the rest of mankind. So it's really a sociological sign. suspect it has a lot to do with the capacity to compare religions or look at different philosophies. The ruling planet of Sagittarius is Jupiter, Zeus. Zeus, who overtook and combat Saturn and changed the rulership of the Olympian period of time by overtaking and beating his father, really, out of the throne. Jupiter is always being known as a wise, just god, which is kind of interesting because, if anything, Zeus was very, very aggressive, very violent, and totally self-oriented while he sought for peace. In other words, it's a very autocratic type of sign. Within us, we usually act out of a belief system. We always say, I believed that I should have done that. So a belief system, which is a Sagittarian concept, can also be dogmatic. It isn't always lighthearted, jovial, and wonderful. It can also be very dogmatic. In fact, the whole Sagittarian realm is very much related to another type of breadth of experience. It's a fire sign associated with Aries and Leo. Needs to feel that it's really burning, that it's got inspiration. Very easily bored. It's a polarity of Gemini. Needs a lot of experiences, a lot of variety in its life. But it needs the kind of variety that will take it beyond the type of esoteric religious focus that one person believes in. This has to do with the anthropological aspects of mankind, us along with everyone else. So it's not a singular sign. Sagittarius, yes, is philosophical. Often we'll find a reason for things where there may seem to be none. It is the thing within us, the capacity to understand and to render everything that happens, that we do, meaningful. In a sense, our beliefs have to be tested, don't they, before we can take and exercise them against the backdrop of society, which is Capricorn. The sign of Capricorn is a cardinal sign, like Aries and Cancer and Libra. Therefore, Capricorn is a number one type of sign. It's there to stabilize. It's an earth sign. It's there to create order out of chaos, in a sense. It is there to establish within us a value system, one which is practical. All right, this is not an experimental sign. This sign loves to know exactly what is going on. Try and explain to a Capricorn in vague, nebulous terms something that is somewhat questionable, and you will have questions fired at you from right and left. It is extremely important that mythologically, Saturn ruling the sign of Capricorn, understanding that Saturn was Cronus in the earlier myths, in the Greek myths, became Saturn during the Roman period of time. In fact, Saturn and Saturn's realm was noted for its peacefulness, its equality. There was a certain amount of generosity that we all shared during that period of time when Cronus was the main ruler. In fact, I think a lot of the association with status and the status quo and the gradual climb in the social ladder and the need for security and the need for recognition and the need for perfection of Capricorn comes from the racial guilt of Saturn, who devoured each of his children. The first five, because he had heard that fate had decreed that he would be overthrown by one of his children. So he ate the first five. His wife managed to hide away the sixth child that was born, who was in fact Zeus, and as fate will be, Zeus or Jupiter overtook, and there was a great bloody war that dethroned Saturn and brought in the new Zeus or Jupiter reign. So Saturn often has the feelings of guilt, obligation, and responsibility. Now, this is not something that a Capricorn or the part of us that is Capricorn has actually done. It's simply that there's a part of us that is serious, that needs to be recognized, and has to have the status quo in agreement. It leads into the sign of Aquarius, the ruler of which is Uranus, and Uranus was the god of the sky, father of heaven, who mated with Gaia, Mother Earth, to produce the realm that we operate within today. Harking out of the unconsciousness of the Aquarian personality process is the ultimate need for freedom. As a result, the sign of Aquarius is very often associated with the freedom of the future, the Aquarian age, the brotherhood and love. This has more to do not with brotherhood and love, but with a state of equality that allows heaven and earth to unite under one, giving us the sensation of equality. So Aquarius is, yes, it's called the water bearer, however, it is more likely the ether pourer. In other words, the stuff that is flowing out of the urn of Aquarius is really the communication, the fifth element of ether that gives us the capacity to telepathically communicate. Uranus is a fixed planet. A sign of Aquarius is a fixed sign. It's always kind of funny when I'm approached about how wonderful Aquarius is and how free-thinking and how easygoing it is. Not a bit. It is stubborn, just as willful as Taurus, Leo, and Scorpio. It's an air sign. Aha! That is important because air signs are associated with what? Objectivity, with academic intellectual observance. So there definitely is a part of the Aquarian mind and part of ourselves that is coldly, clearly objective, that has to do with the future at any price, progress. It has to do with let's get ahead. It has to do with what kind of returns can I get out of my investment in life, which is the Aquarian function. In fact, it being an air sign and fixed shows a certain stubbornness of idea. So therefore, we can often take a look at the sign of Aquarius as part of our horoscope, or if you have Aquarius located prominently, you will see that there is a part of you that is somewhat like ice crystals in outer space. This is the image I get from Aquarius. It's very observant, fast moving, it's very airy. It also has the capacity for firmness and thoroughness. We end up moving into the final sign of the zodiac, Pisces, last but certainly not least. Pisces is ruled by Neptune or Poseidon, who is the Lord of the Sea. And we all seem to be able to relate very comfortably to the ocean as being a part of our collective unconscious. As a result, the Piscean nature can draw, if you will, feelings, moods, themes from a room indiscriminately. It's like a psychic sponge. There's a rich inner world. Neptune creates for us the idea of illusory yet beautiful couching, almost like the veil of life, the veil of mystery behind which we don't hide, though we can, and this is certainly part of Pisces, we need to escape sometimes, but the veil that of mists that surrounds the whole concept of Neptune, Pisces, it's a water sign, it's a mutable sign. It is a sign which can change and adapt so readily that there needs to be quite a lot of control exercised when operating out of the Piscean realm. The ruler Neptune, God of the sea, holds court over the collective network of mankind so that we have with us a connection to each and every individual through myths, through dreams, through memories, through trance states. In fact, a trance state does not have to be induced with the Piscean person. They can slip into it. So the part of us that sleeps, dreams, remembers, is there for the beauty of the future, and in fact, the Piscean realm is the gentle realm of escape. Each of the last of these signs has its lesson as well. Libra is to learn to share without losing the self. Scorpio must learn to be powerful without manipulation. Sagittarius must learn breadth without becoming too scattered. Capricorn has to learn control without becoming all-powerful. Aquarius needs to learn to look into the future without ignoring the present, and Pisces needs to be feeling and receiving without being a victim of circumstance. So you can see the evolution of all 12 signs really fits in well with the evolution of our nature, processes of personality, developments, in fact, related to our mythical past, creating for us dimensions. Dimensions beyond belief, creating for us a life of rich myth, and we act these out as the gods within. We act them out as processes of personality development. Astrology is a helping tool And through the understanding of the processes of development of the signs, you will actually become more of yourself rather than less.